A very good morning and welcome to a new episode of Melt. I'm Ritvika Gupta reporting from my home. Yes, we're still working from home. Now, the lockdown has altered our media consumption habits. Digital consumption has increased significantly, and this has resulted in more and more brands fast-tracking digital solutions to reach out to consumers. Media buying has also changed, with companies now moving to a real-time bidding system. What does this mean for the industry? We find out today from Rahul Welde, Executive Vice President, Digital Transformation, Unilever. But before that, Anand Rangaswamy, editor of Mel, joins me today. Hi, Anand. So in your conversation with Rahul Welde, he mentions that the advertising industry is going to see a change in the way it used to trade. What does he mean by that, and what are the implications?
Ritvika, there's some incredible implications of what Rahul just said. Basically, it's important to remember that trading is a very important part of the revenue stream of media agencies. And digital is the fastest growing part of media. So if digital trading, which in Rahul's opinion is going to shrink, well, the media agency's income is going to shrink. That's a far-reaching and fairly frightening implication of what Rahul was saying. Similarly, one cannot rule out that other parts of media will also be forced by the clients to find platforms where trading can be done in a transparent way. But Rahul underlines it's not going to happen today or tomorrow, but it could happen. And when it does happen, the implications are the same.
Well, thanks, Anand. Let's have a look at your chat with Rahul Welde, who joins us from London. Today's interview was recorded over Skype, so our apologies for the patchy stream. On that note, let's get ready to melt with Rahul Welde.
Rahul, good to talk to you in difficult circumstances, but good to talk to you.
Yeah, great. Thanks, Anand. Good talking to you as well.
And good to see you drinking from a Liverpool cup.
That is absolutely right. I'm missing the football season, and I'm glad you noticed. It is very much my Liverpool cup.
Anyway, get down to business. You know, one of the cartoons doing the rounds nowadays is who has caused digital disruption in the company, in companies. Is it the CTO, the CIO, or is it COVID? Now, I want to ask you, has the coronavirus accelerated digital transformation in companies? Companies across the spectrum.
Yeah, the short answer is yes, indeed. I think the virus and the pandemic has accelerated the entire thinking around digital. But before we talk about companies, take a step back and look at what's happening to consumer behavior, right? And clearly, you see a rate of acceleration in consumer behavior, consumer adoption of technology, which we previously have not seen. I think we must not forget that even before the pandemic, digital transformation, digital acceleration was very much happening all around the world, right? So across different aspects of whether it is consumer adoption or business. And what's happened is that the trajectory of many of these things has only got accelerated very dynamically. I might also add that it's not only consumer behavior, but naturally then the responses of all businesses. So small, medium, large companies, corporations, everyone is then looking at this very, very differently. I mean, just to give you as an example, if you think of the restaurant industry, and it's looking at, this whole aspect very differently. For example, in China now, restaurants have started opening up, and as people go into restaurants, there's some wipes, there is a digital device on which you place your order and goes directly to the kitchen. So that's a digital transformation in some ways of or digital acceleration. Likewise, if you see the impact on education and what's happening, it's certainly the entire industry is getting very transformed, I would say, with students basically attending online classes. Some of these shifts are going to be transformational. Another great example is e-commerce and the virtual online ordering taking off. I know that in India, there is a restriction on e-commerce at the moment. But in most other places, you see a virtual boom of e-commerce, which in any case was growing very fast, but even faster. So to your question, therefore, as companies, I think it's inevitable that you have to respond to this change. So there's a demand side change where consumers are adopting it differently. And clearly then, digitization of operations and supply chains also is a big imperative. So all around, certainly this is a big, big moment of acceleration. Unfortunately, due to the pandemic, but even otherwise, I think it's fair to say that it was moving very fast.
Right. Now, one of the
funny impacts of the coronavirus in India is the forced change in some media consumption. For example, up to today, we don't have home delivery of newspapers in India. I mean, not in India, in Bombay we don't. Some pockets of Delhi receive it, some pockets of Chennai receive it, and so on. Now, what do you think the impact of this whole lockdown is on media consumption habits and therefore on the impact on brands and how they will find consumers?
Yeah, no, that's a great point, Anand. If you think of newspapers, a great example, right? So newspapers or newspaper companies, which had already embarked on a digital transformation or a high level of digitization journey, find themselves much better off than those which were merely in the business of printing newspapers. The circulation is either stopped or reduced dramatically. So I think these again, it's a subsection of the media industry, albeit newspapers. But having said that, again, a very dramatic shift. But again, if you think of media consumption in totality, it's changed dramatically. I think it's changed from two perspectives. One is just what people are doing, clearly spending much more time online. And I'm sure that all the stats that you see reveal that very obviously. Number one is more and more time on social media, more and more time on videos. And indeed, more and more time consuming information, including, by the way, dialogues or calls like this, right? I mean, just as an example, if you think of Zoom, Zoom is now a $40 billion plus company, came practically out of nowhere, right? And it's bigger than some of the industries now, actually. So it's just astonishing the rate of change. On a media standpoint, I think we almost always assume that a lot of it is happening, which is frivolous and entertainment. But that's not quite true, because people are consuming much more rich content. And not just for entertainment, but even for information, even for learning. Just as an example, the how-to videos. And, you know, many of us have now had to do stuff at home, which we've never done before. And guess how do we actually begin to learn some of this, either by exchanges or by looking at these how-to videos. So whether it is information, whether it is learning, all of that has taken off. In India, I think there's a peculiar situation because media companies are not able to produce content, right? So especially the television companies. And which means if the production pipeline has stopped, then what do viewers really get to see? I think it's much the same about sports. We were earlier mentioning Liverpool and the Premier League or the IPL. So as many of these things have stalled for the moment, especially as it relates to content production, consumers still want to consume media and are spending more time doing something else.
Right.
You know, we would have normally thought we would have had more rest and recovery time. But I suspect that people are even sleeping less because they're just consuming more media. It's just on different channels. And naturally, digital is by far the biggest of them all.
Rahul, in the last few weeks, I've had extraordinary conversations, you know, with Martin Sorrell, with R.S. Sodhi, with Suresh Narayan from Nestle, with Rama Bijapurkar. And I'm trying to explore, is it a time right now that brands should spend money talking to consumers or not? The jury is kind of out. You know, some people have a view that there's certain messaging which you can carry on doing, certain things you can't. What is your view on this? What should brands do at this time?
I think the advertising and the brand's landscape, particularly as it relates to whether brands should advertise or not, it varies vastly by industry to start with, right?
Right.
And, because you have to be led by the demand supply economics, you know, the economics model. So take, for example, one of the largest advertiser globally, in the digital space is Expedia. And quite naturally, you can't really, and we're talking of billions of dollars over here, right? So really large advertiser, and you can't possibly be advertising anymore. So from 100, it possibly is down to zero or near zero levels in that kind of a sector or a company. Similarly, autos, durables, luxury goods. So there are vast number of sectors, which for the moment have no choice but to take a pause, simply because the economics in the short term have changed very dramatically for those, right? The second is then some sectors where there is ongoing activity, their demand signals are quite strong or ongoing. And indeed, you know, the supply chains are open. And there you will find that, you know, brands will continue to advertise. So I think for sure, this has an adverse impact on the advertising industry or overall media, etc. in general. But it's very sectoral. And I would hesitate to make a broad thing like, you know, all brands should continue to advertise or all brands should go off air. It has to be done very specifically, firstly led by industry and secondly led by the economics of the specific company or the brand. I don't think there is, I mean, I don't know if it adds to the perspective of all the people that you mentioned earlier, But we are tempted often as leaders and as industry to have some of these broad things which are doing the rounds. And I think it's actually a combination of these macro factors. But I can tell you that all decisions are very, very micro. Look, let's not forget that one of the biggest stimulants of consumption, which is what all economies need, by the way, whether it is, you know, developed or emerging markets, it doesn't matter. The biggest stimulant of consumption is advertising, right?
Right.
So we do need, I mean, so there is no doubt in my mind that whether it is for brands or companies or sectors, we are going to need advertising. And advertising is going to play an important role. But that said, is there a pit stop on which everybody should reevaluate what is going on? Absolutely, yes.
We spoke off camera about the dramatic changes we're going to see in the way media is going to be bought by big brands. You know, a shift towards programmatic, more data-driven, and so on and so forth. So what's your take on that? Again, has that been sped up by what we are going through right now?
Yeah, I think that's a great question. This relates, I'll again take a step back, Anand, because this relates to the overall shift that's taking place in the advertising ecosystem. And I would characterize it by three key points. The first is how people are consuming media and content. And that's changing very dramatically, whether it's OTT, whether it's digital media, whether it's television, all of it is changing. The second is, especially when it comes to advertising, one of the implications is that as we go forward, we will see that the data-driven adoption or of tools, technologies, which impact advertising will change very dramatically because every more and more we will see advertising decisions being taken at more data-driven. The second is just the application of technology. There's some great content that you see now being produced without studios, without people, you know, without lots of cameras doing the rounds. And you say, that's great advertising. How did that happen? Now, how does that production come about? It is the use of creativity and technology. So I think when we think of this entire aspect, it's not only in digital that we will see technology changing the advertising ecosystem, but even in what we would otherwise think of television and so on. And you talk about programmatic, right, which is essentially automation of many advertising-led processes, particularly as it relates to media buying and planning. And for sure, they're going to get accelerated. I think it's fair to say that a large number of players will now embrace this even more than they have done, simply because it builds a certain degree of resilience and entire systemic resilience, if you like, you know, which rests reliance on planners and different people in the system versus the machine. So I think it's going to be quite interesting and is going to accelerate for sure.
The last bit that you spoke with regard to the way media is being bought, are we going to see a change in the dynamics or the way companies choose partners, big brands, choose partners in their communication tasks? You know, right now we've been, you know, sort of living with a legacy system, which you do it what you want. There's been some cyberization, but it's come back from 1980 to today. Are we going to see a dramatic shift there?
Yeah, I think, look, the legacy is very strong. We have a very strong heritage in the advertising industry in general. And those are very strong foundations, right? So some of them are led by relationships, but it's also led by very strong fundamentals of how value exchange has taken place between content, between the media companies, between advertisers. I don't think that's going to change. That strong legacy and heritage is what we have to build on. What will, however, be really important now, and I think this is a very important dynamic in the value exchange mechanism. And previously, if you remember, it used to be all about negotiated deals and negotiated prices. And there was a certain way in which, you know, the entire advertising industry traded, essentially, right? And especially when it came to media. A lot of that has now moved on to the auction or the bidding system, which really creates a very different level of price transparency, one, and two, a very different level of demand-supply dynamics, right? And you see the impact during the course of the crisis, the biggest impact that you will see, whether it is, of course, in the negotiated advertising ecosystem, but also in the auction or the you know, bidding-led ecosystem. And that is something which is, I think, a very big shift. To your point of, you know, 20 years back or 30 years back, all the deals were pretty much struck always. The pricing was determined by the buyer and seller in closed rooms. And now it's all out in the open. It's all, you know, auction-led. And when I say all, meaning naturally not all, but large parts of the digital ecosystem are auction-led.
Yeah, now that's very important. You said not all. Now, could we foresee in hurrying up of all moving to auction. For example, could television move to auction? Could print buying move to auction? Is that going to be forced by this rather than what is becoming archaic negotiated pricing?
I think it could, it will accelerate. I'm sure that both on the side of people who are buying as well as people who are selling, they are always looking at these options. That mechanism comes with two fundamental aspects or issues. The first is a good call on what is the demand supply, right? Because whichever side you're on or whatever you're thinking of, you have to think of how is that going to impact. And that's what actually would keep people awake. The second is it can only be enabled by technology.
Right.
I don't know how many inches or column centimeters or how many spots or whichever is the format of inventory. To trade that with a mechanism which is auction-led requires an enormous amount of investment in technology. Not, you know, we can't take that lightly. It's huge. So for a company to, I don't think that shift will happen very dramatically and overnight or, you know, in the next few months. It is a very, very big shift because traditional companies may not have that kind of technology at the moment. And what we'll see, however, is that as the companies, media companies in particular, become total conglomerates or total companies across digital spectrum as well as the traditional television spectrum, take Disney as an example, or you take, you know, many of the other companies, then we will see that spread taking place, right? So over the top technology is going to enable that or accelerate that. But is the big industry that we have going to change overnight or in a matter of a few months or years to auction? I think it's some time away.
And I'm going to close this because we need a kind of longish answer from you. This is part to your competence as a professional and in part to your fandom. So tell me, what is going to happen to live sports and so on? I mean, again, the jury is out. Will it ever come back to what it was? How will brands see live sports if you're going to see, say, stadiums which are one third full, and so on and so forth, because there are a lot of permanent changes we're going to see.
Yeah, I think that's something that I think about very deeply out of my personal passion for sports.
Yeah.
My reading is that it's going to come back, right?
Right.
Because it is by far one of the things which is top of mind for many people. Just as an example, and nothing connected with what we're speaking about now, but as it happened, I did a small Twitter poll yesterday on four different things of what people are missing most, right? So literally yesterday, the poll is still on, by the way. And guess what is number one? People are missing most football and sports. Now, that may be because it is my... I have no doubt in my mind that that's something that people are missing most. Now, how will it evolve and how will it take shape? Clearly, there are signs and different leagues and different countries are adopting positions which vary. So, for example, in some cases, it's going to be deferred for a while. In some cases, it's canceled. Some cases, it's going to be in camera, right? So, I think as countries open up, it is inevitable that people will start... watching, because people want to watch, people want to play. So it's going to come back. And actually, if you again give a slightly different dimension, you know, for health of the economy, for health of the people, for health of the community, guess what? We want people to be out and about practicing sport, playing sport. We want the kids to go out to the playgrounds. So I don't think it's going to go away for sure. What will happen, however, is that in the short term, there will be these variations which are in the nature of, like I described, in camera, etc. What does that mean from an ecosystem of brands or advertisers? Think about it, you know. So it's all going to go, if the matches are being played in camera, what's the value of the billboards and the hoardings and the sponsorships on ground, right? Vis-a-vis. So the valuation dynamics change very dramatically. The gate revenues for teams, suddenly, you know, that entire revenue base is not there anymore in the short term if everything is in camera. And does that then get recovered by the additional broadcasting revenues or the advertising revenues, or do they take a hit? I think that industry will have these dynamics which will impact in many different ways than just, you know, you and me as viewers enjoying sport. Because think about it logically, you know, for everything else being equal, if the gate revenues are lower, we got to make up for that as television viewers. So we got to pay more in one form or another, or somebody has to pay for it. or indeed the salaries of players or some of the parts have to be compressed. So I think you'll see in the next 2-3 years, these dynamics play out very, very strongly. I think it's interesting, you know, I just read again yesterday this idea of golf courses opening up in Ireland, and they've said like golf courses are going to open and there's going to be very clear rules on how many people play. Obviously lesser than before, and at a given point in time, the distancing. Now, all of that means that just fewer people play. So how does the golf course remain viable, right? Now, I'm giving an example of a golf course and range it to a big Premier League or an IPL team or a broadcaster. So the industry economics in the next 2-3 years are going to see all these shifts. Those who are strong, you know, those companies which have good balance sheets, have, you know, resilient cash situation, will come out much stronger. But equally, many others will be under pressure. So this is a very different dynamic, and for sure it's going to be quite interesting. I just hope, as a fan and a viewer, that some sports come. That's something I miss the most.
Cheers. Hopefully, in the course of the next month, we will see one big sporting win for us. And you know, right now you're drinking tea or coffee, but in a better time we'll drink something else. Cheers, Rahul. Thank you so
Thanks
much for this.
Much. Thanks, Anand. Thank you very much.
And that was Rahul Welde telling us how the pandemic is indeed pushing brands and companies into digital transformation and the way they deliver value to customers as a result of the lockdown. Here are some of the key points highlighted in the conversation. Industries such as food and beverage and education are accelerating digital usage. Companies are adopting more digital solutions. People are spending more time on social media and consuming content for information, learning, and entertainment. As far as advertising is concerned, brands across different sectors need to take a pause. However, in sectors where demand is strong, brands will continue to advertise. More companies will embrace programmatic marketing. Media buying will move to real-time auctions. Valuation dynamics and how revenue is calculated will also change for live sports. Anand, before we wrap up, how do you think marketers need to view this change, both in the short run and long run?
Yeah, what are the implications? Some fairly long-term implications. One is, of course, if trading is going to be a shrinking element in the revenue pie of media agencies, that's something media agencies have to worry about. It also means that marketers perhaps will have their lives a little easier as their digital spends increase, which it is for every single marketer in the country, or in the world in fact. Less and less of media planning and buying will have to be done by human teams and more by programmatic. That's got implications as well.
And well, with that, it's a wrap on this episode of Melt. To follow us on social media, our handle is Ready to Melt. You can also stay informed on what's happening in the world of advertising and marketing with our daily Melt update on our website, readytomelt.com. And I'll see you next week, same time, same place. Goodbye.